I'm Lakshmi Prasanna, Assistant Professor, Department of ECE, Institute of Aeronautical Engineering. In this session, we will discuss how to convert TTL to RH232 voltage levels and RH232 to TTL voltage levels. And we will also see what is the need of converting from one voltage levels to another voltage levels. Now, so here, coming to the serial communication standards, there are different serial communication standards. So, some of the serial communication standards are RS-232 and also we have RS-422 and RS-485. So, these are different types of serial communication standards. So, in this serial communication standards, here RS. So, this RS represents recommended standard number. So, RS stands for recommended standard number. So, out of all these serial communication standards, we are going to discuss in detail about this RH232 serial communication standard in this session. Now, so coming to the detailed discussion about this RH232. So here, this RS-232. So here, this RS stands for recommended standard number 232. And so here, what is the purpose of using this RH-232 means? This RH-232 is most widely used serial communication standard in order to interface the external equipment with computers. So here in between this external equipment and computer, we can have this RH-232 standard communication cable. It is a serial communication cable. And so this RH-232 communication standard cable, it is developed by EIA, which is called Electronic Industry Association, and TIA, Telecommunications Industry Association. So these are the industries that has produced this serial communication standard cable RH-232. And so generally this RH-232 cable is used for connecting DTE and DCE devices. So here DTE stands for data terminal equipment. So in this case, for example, data terminal equipment can be considered as a CPU or PC. And DCE stands for data communication equipment. So this data communication equipment can be modem. So this RH-232 uses serial communication. So as we know how the serial communication is performed, the serial communication will be performed bit by bit transmission. That means only one bit will be transmitted at a time. Because in the serial communication, we will have only single wire placed in between transmitter and receiver. So that is why here only one bit will be transmitted at a time. So this RH-232 cable supports serial communication. And here data will be transmitted, we are saying. So generally the data will be transmitted in the form of bits. So here bits represents generally 0 and 1. And so as per TTL, so TTL is called transistor-transistor logic. These levels will be corresponding to 0 volts and 5 volts. So generally data will be transmitted in the form of 0 and 1. But in order to transmit this 0 and 1, it will be converted into TTL voltages. That means here logic 0 will be represented with the help of 0 volts in TTL and logic 1 will be represented with the help of 5 volts. So converting this zeros and ones into 0 volts and 5 volts, this data will be transmitted. So this is what we call transistor-transistor logic. And here, generally, why it is necessary to convert this TTL voltages into RS-232 voltages? Because in some cases during transmission over shorter distances, for example, say without modem, okay, so shorter distances means consider from one room to another room. If you are transferring the data which is in the form of TTL voltages, that is during shorter distance communication, these TTL voltages will be easily corrupted by noise. So in order to avoid this, we are going to convert TTL voltages into RS-232 voltages. And using these RS-232 standard, we are going to transmit into the communication channel. But before the receiver is going to receive that data, again that RS-232 voltages should be converted into TTL voltages before the receiver receives it. This is the main purpose of converting these TTL voltages to RS-232 voltages and RS-232 voltages to TTL voltages. Now, so that is the main purpose of using this RS-232 cable. Now, so here RS-232 defines different set of voltages and currents. And here this RS stands for recommended standard number, whereas here this C is here. Okay, so C is the latest version of that particular standard. And so here before the data is transmitted, the TTL voltages should be converted into RS-232 voltages. So here we know what is meant by TTL voltages means. So logic 0 will be represented with the help of 0 volts, but logic 1 will be represented with the help of 5 volts. So these are the TTL voltages representation. But when this data is transmitted, the TTL voltages should be converted into RS-232 voltage levels. So RS-232 voltages levels means, so the voltage should be changed between -3 to -25 volts if it is logic 1. So to represent logic 1, we should not use 5 volts and send. This 5 volts voltage should be converted into -3 to -25 volts. So here logic 1 will be converted into negative voltages. So you can use here in between -3 to -25, any voltage we can use within this range, and that can be transmitted. And if it is logic 0, the voltage level should be +3 to +25 volts. So if it is logic 0, the voltage range should be +3 to +25 volts. So converting this 0 voltage into another form of voltage, that voltage may be within this +3 volts to +25 volts range, and converting this 5 volts, that is TTL voltage, into this voltage range, that means the voltage range may be -3 to -25 volts, and then only it should be transmitted through the channel. This is what converting this TTL voltages into RS-232 voltage levels. And whereas the voltage range between this -3 and +3 volts, they are undefined. So in order to avoid the noise during short distance communication, it is necessary to convert TTL voltages into RS-232 voltages and RS-232 voltages into TTL voltages before receiving. And so here, before sending, the bits should be changed to this level, and again that voltage level should be reconverted to TTL before receiving. So here, how to make this conversion? That means how to make this TTL voltage levels to RS-232 voltage levels and RS-232 to TTL voltage levels. So in order to do this voltage level conversion, we have here standard chips to perform this operation. So here the standard chips that performs that operation is 1488 and 1489 ICs. So one IC is called line driver, another IC is called line receiver. So these are the two ICs which performs that voltage level conversion. Now, coming to this RS-232C standard, serial communication standard, electrical characteristics. So generally this RS-232C, it is a cable. This cable is single ended. So single ended means here only one wire per signal. Voltage levels are with respect to a system common. That means we will have a signal ground. And another electrical characteristic is mark. So here representing the voltage within this -3 to -25 volts, generally we call it as a mark, because here logic 1 generally in TTL voltage levels it will be represented with +5 volts, whereas in RS-232 that same +5 volts voltage will be represented with another voltage which is in the range -3 to -25 volts. So this voltage is called as mark, and the voltage which is used to represent logic 0 is called as space. Here generally if it is TTL voltage, logic 0 will be represented with the help of 0 volts TTL voltage. If we convert that 0 volts into RS-232 voltage levels, it will be converted into another voltage, and it can be represented with the help of any voltage within this +3 volts to +25 volts. So representing in this manner, generally it is called as space. So this is what about the mark and space electrical characteristic. Now, so whereas here the voltage levels in between this -3 and +3 volts, we should not use that voltage levels in order to represent any data, because that voltage levels are undefined. Whatever the voltage that is present in between -3 to +3 volts, they are called undefined voltage levels. So we should not use that voltage levels to indicate any logic. And so here coming to this RS-232C cable standard, its cable length is 15 meters and it is capable of transmitting 20 kilobits per second. And here, what is meant by slew rate? This is also one of the important electrical characteristic. So here, slew rate is defined as the rate of change of signal levels. Why? Because here we are talking about the TTL to RS-232 voltage level conversions and how to represent 0 volts in RS-232 and 5 volts in RS-232. So that is why here we have to talk about slew rate. So here slew rate is defined as the rate of change of signal levels. So the maximum slew rate for this RS-232, it is limited to 30 volts per microsecond. Also the maximum bit rate is 20 kilobits per second. So this is what about the slew rate and bit rate of RS-232C serial communication standard cable. Now, so if you are using the serial communication standard having these specifications of bit rate and slew rate, it is capable of reducing the crosstalk with adjacent signals. Now, so generally here, now we will see what are the different applications of this RS-232 between computer and modem. So here, generally this RS-232 cable is used to connect DTE and DCE devices, that is data terminal equipment and data communication equipment devices. So here this DTE device can be considered as a computer, whereas DCE device can be considered as a modem. Now we have to learn how the communication between this computer, that is DTE and DCE devices, are performed by using this RS-232 serial communication standard. Now, these two devices, that is computer and modem, will be communicating with each other using RS-232 interface, and communication between the modem is established by using the telecommunication links. So here, this is the example how the communication is performed between this DTE and DCE devices, and how these two DCE devices will be communicating and how the data will be transferring between the two computers. So here this is a DTE, which is called data terminal equipment, and here we have this RS-232 serial communication standard. So this DTE and DCE devices will be communicating by using this RS-232 cable. Why? Because there is necessity to convert the TTL voltages that have been generated by this computer into RS-232 voltages. Then the RS-232 voltages should be given to this DCE. So in order to make that, here this RS-232 communication cable is here. And this two DCE devices will be communicating with the help of this telecommunication link. And again, this DCE and DTE will be communicating with another RS-232 communication cable. Now, here, the frame format of RS-232 protocol. Generally, here RS-232 protocol follows asynchronous communication protocol. So here we know what is meant by asynchronous communication protocol. So in the asynchronous communication, here there will not be any external clock signal in order to synchronize between transmitter and receiver. This RS-232 supports serial communication only, but here again in the serial communication, we have different protocols like synchronous serial communication or asynchronous serial communication. So this RS-232 supports asynchronous communication protocol. So in this, no clock signal is used to have the synchronization between transmitter and receiver. So since there is no clock signal here, how to send the data between transmitter and receiver means, along with the original data, we have to include the start bits and stop bits. That is why here stop bits and start bits will be used. Why? Because in order to say the receiver that what is the original data, whether it has been transmitted or not. So using the start bits and stop bits only, the synchronization between transmitter and receiver will be happening. And so now if we consider here, this is the frame format. And this frame format, if you want to transmit by using this RS-232 cable, here this bit will be fixed to 1, and this 2, S1 and S2, these two bits represent stop bits. Here stop bits may be 1 or 1.5 bits or 2 bits. Okay. So based on the number of stop bits, we have to include here the number of stop bits. As we know, the stop bits will be indicated with a value 1, whereas the start bit will be indicated with a value 0. And after stop bits, the next bit should be the parity bit. So here, the parity bit may be included or not included. For example, if the parity bit is not included, the character length will be increased. Here, this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. If the parity bit is not included, here also you can include the data bit so that the character length will be 9 when this parity bit is included, the character length maximum we can have is only 8. So if there is parity, only 8 characters can be sent. If there is no parity, in that also you can send the data bit. So the total character length will be 9. And after the entire character has decided, the last bit will be the start bit. So the start bit will be indicated with 0. So this is the frame format of RS-232 protocol. And here this is the data which is fixed to 1. And these two bits represent stop bits. Stop bit representation will be indicated with 1. So here the stop bits used are 2. It may be 1 stop bit. It may be 1.5 bits or it may be 2 bits. But here it is used, in this case, 2. And next, whatever the data, this is here, this bit represents parity bit. So here the parity bit, if it is 1, it indicates even parity. If it is 0, it indicates odd parity. And the remaining bits, whatever it is transmitting, all these bits are representing the character length. Okay. So here, if there is no parity, the character length will be only 9. If there is parity bit, the character length will be only 8. And the last bit will be the start bit. Start bit will be indicated with 0. So here, since this RS-232 supports asynchronous communication, it is necessary to include start bit and stop bit in the frame format. And so generally, we have seen the frame format. While transmitting that data from sender to the receiver, first the transmitter, that is the transmitter is DTE here, data terminal equipment, which is called PC. So during this transmission, DTE sends start bit to the receiver first. The DCE to inform that data transmission has been started. So when the start bit is sent first to the receiver, it indicates that data transmission has started. And whatever the data coming after this start bits are called the original data, that is character. And after completing all the start bits, the stop bit will be sent. Generally here the start bit will be sent first. It will be indicated with 0. And but the 0 will be represented with the help of RS-232 voltage levels. After this start bit is received by the DCE device, that is receiver, whatever the data it is transmitting next, the data character length may be either 5, 6, 7, 8 or maximum it will be 9. So the character length will be decided by the status word register format and control word register format. So after start bit, whatever the data it is transmitting next, those will be considered as the data bits. After the complete character is sent, here, I told you the parity bit, here it may be used or not used. For example, if the parity bit is used, maximum character length will be 8 bits that will be transmitted. If the parity is not used, 9 bits can be transmitted because in place of parity bit, the data bit can be included. So after the data is transmitted, the transmitter sends the stop bit. Stop bit is the last bit. So here, stop bit will be indicated with 1. So it can be either 1 bit or 1.5 bit or 2 bits long. Now, so we will see RS-232 voltage level converters. So here it is required to convert TTL to RS-232 and RS-232 to TTL voltage level, because if you are transmitting the TTL voltage levels in the short distance communication, that voltage levels will be easily corrupted by noise. That is why it is necessary to have voltage level conversion. And here are the two ICs which will be making this voltage level conversion. So those ICs are called driver ICs and receiver ICs. So if you consider here, this is a CPU. So here this CPU is DTE. Okay. And here this serial interface, generally it is called USART, that is USART 8251 it is. So this is also USART, and here it is one more DTE, that is CPU. And here we can see 1488. Okay. So here this 1488 IC is called line driver. Okay. So this IC is used to convert TTL to RS232 voltage level conversion. And here we have one more IC which is called 1489. So this 1489 IC is called line receiver. So this IC is used to convert RS232 to TTL voltage level conversion. So here we can see this is RS232 cable. This 1488 is used to convert TTL to RS232. And this voltage level will be passed through the communication channel. But before it is received by the receiver, it has to be converted to TTL again. So in order to convert this RS232 voltage level to TTL, we are using here one IC which is called 1489. So that 1489 will perform RS232 to TTL conversion. And so if this CPU wants to communicate with another CPU, so whatever the data it is received, again it sends, because it is having TTL. Okay, so TTL should be converted into here. Generally here across 1488, so this is TTL, it converts into RS232. Why? Because here TTL to RS232, if the conversion data transmission is like this, this 1488 IC will convert this TTL to RS232, and this voltages here we will have RS232. Before going to give it to the CPU, it has to be converted into RS232 to TTL by using this 1489 IC. But internally here, each line driver and line receiver IC will be having 4 inverters. So this is the main purpose of using this line driver and line receiver ICs between this serial interface and this RS232 cable. And so line driver and line receivers, that is 1488 and 1489 ICs. So almost all digital devices which we use require either TTL or CMOS logic levels. So two common RS232 level converters are, one is 1488, another one is 1489. So this 1488 IC, it is called RS232 driver IC. It takes characters from 8251, which is USART, and put them on the interconnection cable by using RS232 voltages. That means here the TTL voltages will be converted into RS232 voltages by using this RS232 driver IC. And next one is 1489 IC, which is called as RS232 receiver ICs. So the function of this IC in the diagram, what I have shown in the previous slide, it takes RS232 voltages as received and passes them to one of the receiver portions of 8251, that is USART. And so this 1489 IC, generally it is used for converting RS232 voltages to TTL voltage levels. And so each line driver or line receiver IC, it is having 4 inverters. So here are the 4 inverters. So if you consider here, this is 1488, and this 1488 is called line driver. Okay, so this line driver IC is used to convert TTL voltage levels to RS-232 voltage levels. And here we have 1489. So this 1489 is called line receiver IC, which is used to convert RS-232 voltage levels to TTL voltage levels. And here these are the four inverters used in each driver and receiver ICs. So here we have the signal like TXD transmit data, RTS request to send, DTR data terminal ready. So all of this, by using all these signals only, this conversion will be performed. Similarly, we have at 1489 IC, this is RXT receiver data, CTS clear to send, and DSR data set ready, and this is CD, carrier detect. So these are the TTL to RS-232 and RS-232 to TTL conversion line driver and line receiver ICs. And here RS-232, it is a communication cable which consists of signals, pins. Generally this RS-232, it will be available in 25 pin package and also 9-pin package. So this is the representation of 25-pin RS-232 cable. And here it is having all the 25 pins. This is from pin 1 to 13 and here pin 14 to 25. And here if you see the pins, it is having protective ground, transmitted data, received data, requested to send, clear to send, data set ready, signal ground, data carrier detect. These two signals are reserved and this is unassigned. And this is secondary data carrier detect. So this is secondary data carrier detect. Why? Because already we have here data carrier detect signal. Here this one is called secondary clear to send. Why? Because already we have here clear to send signal. And next one is secondary transmitted data. This is transmit clock. Secondary received data, receiver clock. This signal unassigned, no function for this. Secondary request to send, data terminal ready, signal quality detector. And here it is ring indicator, data rate select, external clock. And this is also unassigned. So if you consider here, this is a 25-pin RS-232. So generally, we use 9-pin RS-232. Now considering here 9-pin RS-232 cable, we will see what are the 9 pins that are available here. So this is pin number 1. So this is 2, 3, 4. And here 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So these are the 9 pins of RS-232 cable. So RS-232 cable is available in 25 pin and 9 pin also. So we will discuss about this 9-pin RS-232 cable in detail. Function of each signal and all. How using RS-232, DTE and DCE will be communicating. And so this is pin 1. This is DCD. So here DCD represents data carrier detect. And here next pin 2 is RXD. So RXD represents receiver data. And next third pin is TXD. So here TXD represents transmitter data. Next pin 4, it is DTR. So DTR stands for data terminal ready. And the next pin 5, it is GND. So it represents ground. And next pin 6 is DSR. So DSR represents data set ready. And next one is pin 7, which is called RTS. So RTS stands for request to send. And the next pin 8 is CTS. So here CTS stands for clear to send. And last signal is pin 9, which is called RI. So RI indicates here ring indicator. So all these are the 9 signals that are available in the 9-pin RS232 connector. So we will discuss about all these 9 pins. So among the 9 pins, 6 signals comes under handshaking signals, whereas the remaining 3 are the normal pins available in this 9-pin RS232 cable. So we will see what are the 6 handshaking signals and what are the remaining 3 signals, totally 9 signals. Now, so first let us discuss the function of these pins by considering the DCE and DTE devices. So here, the two terms commonly seen in the serial communication are DTE and DCE. So DTE stands for data terminal equipment and DCE stands for data communication equipment. Now, so these terms are used to indicate pin out for connectors on the device and direction of signals on the pins. So the computer and terminals that send and receive data, generally these type of devices can be considered as DTE devices. That means the devices, whatever sends or receive the data, those devices can be called as data terminal equipment. And the devices like modem which transfer the data can be considered as DCE devices. So that is why in this example, we will consider CPU as DTE and modem as DCE device. Now we will see how the connection will be establishing between these two devices by using this RS232 cable. Now, so generally the DTE devices uses a male connector of RS232, whereas DCE devices uses a female connector of RS232 cable. Now, so here this is the data terminal equipment. Here we have considered this PC as an example under this DTE device. And here this is DCE, data communication equipment. And we have to consider here the device which is able to transfer the data. So that is why we have considered here modem. So just we have seen the 9-pin RS232 cable. So that 9 pins are available here, which will be used for communicating between this DTE and DCE devices. So here we have DCD, that is data carrier detect, DSR, data set ready, DTR, data terminal ready, and RTS, request to send, CTS, clear to send, and TXT, transmit data, and this is RXT, receive data. So generally here this RS232C is having 9 pins. Among that 9 pins, 6 pins comes under handshaking signals. So here the 6 pins DTR and DSR, and next is RTS, CTS, DCD and RI. Okay, so this is one pair of handshaking signal, this is another pair, and this is another pair of handshaking signals. Totally 6 signals will be available in the handshaking mechanism. So whereas this RXD, TXD and SG, these are also the pins of RS232, because but they are the normal pins, not handshaking signals. Here this DTR and DSR are one pair of handshaking signals. Okay, and next to this RTS and CTS is another pair of handshaking signals. This DCD and RI is one pair of handshaking signals. Now we will see how the operation is performed by using these handshaking signals between this DCE and DTE devices. Now, so handshaking in RS232 protocol by using control signals. Here, they are used for handshaking. Just we, I have shown you the six signals. Using that six signals only, the handshaking will be done. So here DTE equipment, we have considered PC as an example. Whereas DCE equipment, we have considered modem, for example. Now, we want to perform the data transfer between the DTE and DCE devices. For that, we are using six handshaking signals to perform that data transfer. Now, here what are that six handshaking signals means? One is DTR. So, DTR represents data terminal ready. So, when this data terminal equipment is on after its self-test, it sends out DTR indicating the readiness for communication. So, generally, here if you consider, this is a data terminal equipment which is called PC. And here if we consider, this is a DCE device which is called modem. So, this DTR signal will be sent from this PC to modem. So, when this signal is sent, it indicates that this DTE, that is PC, is ready for communication. Once if the modem receives that signal, it is going to send another signal which is called DSR. So, DSR signal will be sent from modem to PC, that is from DCE device to DTE device. So, DSR stands for data set ready. So, when this modem is turned on, it sends DSR signal after its self-test. So, with the help of these two handshaking signals, what is the function that will be performed means? So, here in this case, the modem sends this signal to the PC port, which indicates that it has made a connection to the network. So, by these two signals, handshaking operation, the function that will establish is, it will make, both of them will make a connection to the network. So, together this DTR and DSR used to confirm that the devices are connected and they are turned on. So, that is the purpose of these two signals, handshaking signals. And the next handshaking signals are RTS and CTS. So, RTS is called request to send. Okay. So, based on the previous two handshaking signals, both the devices have established the communication. Now, the data transfer should be performed. So, that is what happens with the help of this request to send and clear to send signals. So, here, now, both the equipments are turned on, data transmission can be performed. So, if the DTE device has a byte to send, it will give a signal RTS to DCE device. That means here, if you consider here, this is a DTE and here it is DCE. That means DTE is PC and this DCE is modem. And the signal will be sent from PC to modem. That signal is called RTS, request to send. So, this signal will be sent from PC to the modem, indicating that it has data to send. After the signal is received by the modem, it will send, the modem will send one more signal to the PC, which is called CTS. So, CTS stands for clear to send. So, whenever the modem sends CTS signal to PC, it indicates that there is a buffer space available for the incoming data at the DCE device. So, with the help of these two handshaking signals, together this RTS and CTS signals are used for hardware flow control. That means it regulates the flow of data. For example, if there is no buffer space available at the DCE device, it is not going to send the signal which is called CTS. So, if the CTS is not received by the PC has to wait until CTS signal has come. Generally, when it won't send the CTS signal, it indicates that the DCE is not having the buffer space. So, the transmission must wait until the buffer is cleared. So that is what the operation performed by the two handshaking signals. The last two handshaking signals are DCD, that is a data carrier detect, and ring indicator. So here data carrier detect. So here generally if we consider this is a DTE and here this is a DCE. So it is PC and this is modem. Okay. So here the signal is DCD, that is data carrier detect. This signal will be sent from modem to PC. Okay. So this signal will indicate that the carrier has been detected. And with this DCD signal, the modem is going to send the output signal, which is called ring indicator. Okay. So this is an output signal saying that the telephone line is ringing. That means the modem will be toggling. It goes on and off, indicating that the incoming call rings the phone. So these are the six handshaking signals, but RS-232 cable is 9-pin. Coming to the remaining 3 pins here. Now, so the function of these two handshaking signals are saying the information related to connection to the modem. The remaining 3 signals, normal signals, are one is RXD. So RXD stands for receiver data. So when this signal is asserted, it indicates that the receiver is ready to receive the data. And next signal is TXD. So TXD represents transmit data. So this terminal indicates that here the signal from the data is set, and confirmation that there is a connection between the data terminal and data set. And the 9th signal here, it is SG. So SG indicates signal ground. So this is the signal ground for this RS-232 cable. So it offers a written path for the signal communication. So without signal ground, serial data cannot be transmitted between DTE and DCE devices. And here these are the differences between serial communication standards. So here we have all the parameters related. And here we have this RS-232, 422 and 485 different serial communication standards. So based on all these parameters, the serial communication standards values will be different. So generally we have considered here RS-232. So the cable length here, it is single ended. Number of devices that you can connect by using RS-232 is one transmitter and one receiver. But whereas RS-422, we have 5 transmitters and 10 receivers. RS-485, 32 transmitters and 32 receivers can be connected. And here RS-232 supports full duplex communication mode, whereas 422 supports both full duplex and half duplex, whereas RS-485 supports half duplex communication mode. So the maximum distance that RS-232 supports is 50 feet at 19.2 kilobits per second, and RS-422 4000 feet at 100 kilobits per second, 4000 feet at 100 kilobits per second, that is 485. And maximum data rate of RS-232 is 19.2 kilobits per second at 50 feet. And here 422 is 10 Mbps at 50 feet, whereas RS-485 is 10 megabits per second at 50 feet. And the signaling mode in this RS-232 case is unbalanced, whereas RS-422 and 485, these are balanced. And so using this mark signal, generally in RS-232, it will be indicated with -5 to -15 volts. And in RS-232 and 485, it will be indicated with the help of positive voltages only. Here, space will be indicated with the help of positive voltages in RS-232, that is between +5 volts to +15 volts. whereas in RS422 and 485 also, it is indicated with positive voltage levels only, same as Mark 1. And output current capability for RS232, it is 500 milliamperes. In RS422, 150 milliamperes, and RS485, it is 250 milliamperes. So these are the differences between different serial communication standards. And coming to the next communication cable, that is USB. So USB stands for Universal Serial Bus. So here this USB is one of the computer port. Instead of this USB, previously the computers used to have serial and parallel ports, but now all the computers have the USB ports only. So using this USB ports only, we can connect different devices like keyboards, mouse, external devices like printers, scanners, digital cameras. All these devices can be connected to a computer by using this USB port only. And so if you wanted to connect more number of peripherals to the same USB port, it is also possible by using this USB hubs. So many devices can be connected to the USB port at a time by using this USB hubs. So this USB has replaced the previously available ports for a computer like serial ports and parallel ports. So USB is faster compared to the previous serial and parallel ports. That is why USB is preferred. And this is the symbol to represent the USB port, and this is the physical view representation of USB port. And so some of the features of this universal serial bus is, it is simple connectivity and also simple cable. It is one interface for many devices, that means using USB hub, and automatic configuration, no user settings, high reliability, low cost, low power consumption, flexibility, and also operating system support. So all these are some of the features of USB cable. Now, so different versions are available. So USB 1. So how all these different versions varies means based on the signaling rate. So here USB 1 is called full speed. Why? Because it is having a minimum data rate of 1.5 megabits per second and maximum data rate of 12 megabits per second. And next version of USB is USB 2.0. It is called high speed USB. Its signaling rate is around 480 megabits per second. And another version is USB 3.0. So this version is called super speed. It supports the signaling rate up to 5 gigabits per second. So generally all these are different versions of USB. They differ based on the signaling rate. So among all these, this USB 3.0 reduces the time required for data transmission, reduces power consumption, and is backward compatible with USB 2.0. So that is why out of all the versions, this is preferred. And so this is the USB system design. So in the USB system design, we will have host controller, and this is the device. So this host controller and device will be communicating with this logical pipes. So this logical pipes are used to transfer the data from host controller to the endpoints in the device. So here, USB device communicates with the help of logical pipes. So here, these pipes will be connected between the host controller and endpoint of the device. Here there are two types of pipes. Using these two types of pipes only, the devices will be communicated. The two types of pipes are stream and message. So here, message pipe represents bidirectional and is used for control transferring, whereas stream pipe is unidirectional, that means only one direction. It is connected to a unidirectional endpoint for transferring the data. So using any of these, the data transfer will be performed between host controller and USB device. And so here the components that are available in that USB host design is, one is host controller, another one is USB host, and another device is USB device. So as the name indicates, it is a host controller. So without permission of host controller, any device cannot transmit the data through data bus. So here, first we will discuss about the component host controller. So this host controller is a device that directs the traffic flow between the devices. No USB device can transfer the data on the data bus without permission of this host controller component. And the next block is USB host. So the function of this USB host is, it communicates with the devices using a USB host controller. This USB host is responsible for detecting the devices, managing bus access, performing error checking, providing and managing power, and exchanging data with the devices. So all these functions will be performed by this USB host only. And the next device is USB device. So the USB device implements one or more USB functions, whereas the functions provided one specific capability to the system. So examples of the USB functions may be connecting the keyboards or connecting webcam, connecting speakers or mouse or any external devices. Thank you.
Like, share and subscribe. Hit the bell icon for more updates.